I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be wondering why I'm not standing over there. It's because the speaker hooks onto your pants, except that that part that hooks on broke. And when I slipped it into the edge of my pants, it started to keep slipping on down. And I said, no, this isn't going to work today. We live in unsettled times. Politically, we need only look south of our border to feel the unsettlement. We look to Syria and Europe and its struggles to deal with refugees. When we look at ourselves, even personally, we see that there's unsettlement in terms of jobs and the economy, whether we will have a job or might not have a job. We're worried about our children. We're worried about as we age. You need only forget one thing, and suddenly you're going, oh no, it's happening to me. Dementia is begun. Or you know, the other day I said to myself, you know, I seem to remember in the midst of time that I could move my body with not one ache or pain at all. That is not the situation now. It's like, wait a second, this body's supposed to work for me, and it's not quite as well as I would like it. And so we live in unsettled times in so many different ways, but we also live in in-between times. And the in-between is that the kind of world that we might have been raised in is starting to fray at the edges. The ways that we dealt with the world sometimes don't seem to work so well, and we're not sure what that future thing is going to look like. And we say to ourselves, who will I be? Who will I become? And we wonder about that. And we are not alone in that. In our biblical record, there are many groups that we're dealing with change on a massive scale. Our reading from Isaiah was a reading to the Jewish people in exile. They had developed this relationship with God that was the story of the Exodus. God had taken us out of slavery in Egypt, had brought us into the wilderness, had sustained us in the wilderness, and brought us into the promised land. That was the story, and God was going to be with us always and everywhere. And then we get carted off to Babylon, Jerusalem is destroyed, and who will we be now? Who will we be as a people of God now? In our epistle from Paul to the Philippians, here are a group of people who are trying to figure out what it means to be Christian when Christians never had existed before. And I was Jewish yesterday, but now I'm Christian, and what does that mean? And I was pagan yesterday. I worship the gods. But I'm Christian today, and what's that going to mean for me? And so all of these people, through time, have been asking the same question that we ask, which is, who will we be? And our readings for today give us some clues about how we are meant to deal with these times of unsettlement and in-betweenness and discomfort and unease. The first thing we hear in Isaiah is to not remember the former things. Do not consider the things of old. And what that is basically saying to us is, yes, your history has brought you here, but you cannot sort of depend on that. You cannot sort of relax and think you've got it all sorted out, because God brought you out of Egypt, but what's God doing for you now? You need to be looking forward, be looking for the sights that God is, the new things that God is doing in your community right now. And so that leads me to the next part, which is, if God is doing new things, which is sort of the nature of a creator God, which is to keep doing new stuff, have we got the eyes to see that? Are we alert to where the little sprouts of growth might be? For some of you who have been involved in Messy Church, you could say, I think there might be some little sprouts there. When you get a whole pack of 40 kids together, kind of doing their stuff, there's an energy there that makes you go, wow, there's a little sprout there growing. So then we move into, okay, we're supposed to kind of let go of our past. For us as Christians today, how are we having been called to let go of the way things were? Oftentimes we like to think of that post-war era when, you know, there were Sunday schools of hundreds of kids and there were youth groups and there were people sitting in the pews and we go, wow, that was the time, man, that was the time. If only we could go back to that. And God's saying, are you kidding me? No way! Don't go back! Look forward! Look out! Look around you! Find those sprouts of growth. See what the new way of the church will be. See how we can be for the people in our community in different ways than we've done before. Draw us forward. Now, when we look at that idea of being drawn forward into a future we know nothing of, it's a scary place to go. We don't know what it's going to look like. We don't know whether we've got what it takes. And so our epistle from Paul to the Philippians is giving us some guidance there as well. And that guidance was that here was this guy who was the poster boy for the Jewish faith. I mean, he had it all. You know, circumcised, Pharisee, zealous to preserve the faith. He had it all. And he says in his reading today that it was all garbage in the face of his relationship with the living Christ. That in the face of that relationship that transformed him, all of the rest of it was nothing. And so for us, as we live in uncertain times, in changing times, we have to engage with God with the same level of depth and intensity that Paul engaged with Christ on the road to Damascus and then throughout the rest of his life. We are called to trust in the Lord. The Lord that has brought us all through the generations, has sustained us, and is leading us on, and is growing those little green sprouts that will be the church in the future. So what we need to do then is to trust that God, and to engage that God, and deepen our connection to him. I want to share a story that I read about as I was doing my research for this sermon. John and Charles Wesley, who began the Methodist movement, were young men at Oxford. And they had, John had this conversion experience where he says, my heart was strangely warmed. And he had this incredible depth of connection to God in that moment. And so he and his brother and some other fellows at Oxford began this thing called the Holy Club, which was a group that were trying to intensely connect with God, to deepen their faith in ways that the Anglican Church in England wasn't quite doing it for them. And so they began to read the scripture and to read what God was calling people to. And one of the things that they read was visit people in prison. And so, okay, the Bible says we're going to visit people in prison. We're going to visit people in prison. Well, this was in the mid-1700s. Prisons in England were not pretty places. They were awful places, and particularly debtors' prisons, because you got into the prison because of your debts. And of course, how in prison were you ever going to get the money to pay off your debt, to get yourself out of prison? And so this young group of Oxford students went off to the prisons. Wow, gee, it was kind of amazing. They talked to the prisoners, and they found out what their lives were about, and they found out what was going on in the prisons. And so began a program of prison reform that totally changed. It basically got rid of debtors' prisons altogether, but reformed the lives of prisoners, partly just even from the fact that anybody cared about them enough to come and visit and engage with them and find out what their life was about. Now, did John and Charles Wesley start out thinking they were involved in prison reform? No, not at all. They started out from the position of God and their relationship to Christ and their depth of connection and realizing that God was saying, well, you gotta visit prisoners. And it led on to this whole reform that had never been dreamt of. That is the kind of newness that I'm trying to capture for you, to understand that that's the kind of thing that we are being called to here in Vernon. That we are called to live out our faith in new ways that we have not even begun to pray about. And that's what's so important about the prayer challenge that we've been engaged in. Because in that prayer challenge, we are connecting with God in ways we could have never imagined. We're thinking new thoughts, we're connecting in new ways, we're connecting with one another in different ways, and there are little green sprouts happening all over as a result of that. So when we are thinking about living in unsettled times, living in in-between places, part of what I would say to you is remember, you are the Lord's, and the Lord will call you forward. Thanks be to God.